our next speaker is a fellow patriot. We talked a little bit about patriotism this morning. And he's also a fellow radio host of mine at a Patriot Radio Network, namely GCN. He is the founder of NutraMedical. You can learn about that at NutraMedical.com. He has the NutraMedical show on GCN Radio. And he has been leading an epic struggle against Frankenfoods, Frankenbodies, chips, implants, and all that horrible stuff that they're using to torture the human body in this age of runaway technology and toxic technology. So I'll let Dr. Bill take it over from here. This is Dr. Bill Deagle.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay, we're going to adjust this for Dr. Bill Height. Okay, how many people are tired? If you're not, you're already asleep. Okay. Now, I want to start off my talk. I'm going to talk about some pretty heavy things, and we've talked about a lot of heavy things. What happens to a body, you know, an individual person, an autonomous human being, when exposed to this much data? Even if you're in the movement, is you're going to get overwhelmed. How many people here are not overwhelmed? You're not overwhelmed? Well, you will be shortly. Okay, now here's the thing. When the body reacts, the body responds emotionally, intellectually. Emotionally, your body is going almost like, you know, have you ever gone to a place where you're fearful, whether you're over, let's say, the Niagara Falls, or you're doing something really dangerous, like you're about to bungee jump for the first time. Well, this conference is like we're all lined up on the bridge ready to jump. Now, if you're not fearful, you don't have any common sense. But I tell people, be fearless, but not careless. Because we're dealing with a very dangerous world. There's very great probabilities of futures that are wonderful with advanced technology for energy to clear up our pollution problems. I'm an environmental doctor. Life's extension, reversal of age, wiping out disease. On the other hand, we're at this crossroads or nexus. We're looking at a history where they're trying to literally create a global matrix. Now, some people call this a conspiracy theory. And I want you, whenever you hear, if you only take one thing away from this conference, whenever you hear the words conspiracy, the next word that pops into your head, this is from Dr. Bill, is conspiracy reality. This is not a theory, okay? And you'll see information today, you saw information yesterday. All of the speakers here, none of us are playing ego games, okay? What we're doing is very dangerous, but we're staring down the barrel of the end of human history if we don't stop it. We're also staring down the barrel of an adventurous future where we will spread out across the stars, extending human lifespan, wipe out the pollution, and create a peaceful world where it's fit for human beings and other life forms to live in peace and harmony with their environment. But it's our choice. The primary attack of the New World Order is not Afghanistan, Iraq, or oil. It's you. It's your consciousness. It's your autonomy. If you look at what Connie Fogel said, an amazing woman who's led the Canadian Action Party, and she said that what they're trying to do is take away 800 years all the way from, you know, the Magna Carta in 1215, take away that 800 plus years of rights that have been won for us to be autonomous, to own property, et cetera. They have, by grades and steps, not just recently, but over the last century, done things, and now they've fast-tracked it. How many people feel safer since 9/11, put your hands up. How many people feel the economy has much more future prospects now that George Bush and I call him Hair Bush is in power, and his Fourth Reich Nazis, and Stephen Harper, his Goebbels. You know, he's a three-time Bilderberger. We have to realize the Bilderberg meeting was in Istanbul, Turkey. The G8 meeting was, of course, in Germany recently. They couldn't even riot near them. They were within 110 kilometers because everything's so controlled. There's an author that is on my show regularly. His name is Jeff Grupp. He's a professor at Northwestern University in Indiana, and he talks about a book called Corporatism. So if you go to my websites, and I have two of them, the first one is called NutriMedical, N-U-T-R-I, Medical, M-E-D-I-C-A-L.com, NutriMedical. On that side, I deal with basically natural wellness. I'm a trained, board-certified family internal medicine specialist, as well as occupational environmental medicine, military medicine. I've done work in everything from rural practice. In fact, I did a year of internal medicine training here at the Vancouver General in 77, 78. I've trained in trauma, burn units, emergency department, military medicine, environmental toxicology. I've worked taking care of people at the Aiken Nuclear Reactor site in Georgia, taking care of people working moving radioisotopes, bioweapons, nerve gas, and nuclear warheads. So I know a lot of really bad stuff. I was a doctor for CECOM and many other companies in Colorado between 1994 and 2000. Took care of U.S. Space Command employees, Strategic Defense, Star Wars, NORAD, Falcon Air Force Base, directed energy weapons, bioweapons, and war game simulation Operation Top Off and Dark Winter. Now, that sounds like a long list. You say, how could you be in all those places, Doc? Well, I really believe, just like everyone is here, that we're here because there is a higher purpose. There is a God of the universe. I happen to be a believer, but the fact is, what spiritual viewpoint you come from, you must be driven by emotion. You're not just driven by the intellect. If you just speak to the intellect of other people and say, no, I don't want to believe that's true, it's not their intellect that's telling you no, it's their emotion, okay? The way to get through to people, I think, is to ask what I call Charlie Sheen questions. Don't let them ask the questions. You ask little tiny questions that before they know it, they've taken the red pill. And you can do it over a period of days, weeks, and months because most people don't want the red pill. They don't want to know that the world they think is not a Pollyanna world. It's a world of evil overlords, the desire, your dumbing down, the shortening of your life, serious disease, impoverishment, and death. They don't want to hear that negative side. But on the other side, just like the movie Ants, you know, don't pretend that those ants couldn't do something to us. This is the leader of the wasps in the movie Ants. There's a lot more of those little ants than there are us wasps. Well, yay to us Canadian and American ants. Okay? Now, we're here to empower, and I talked a lot about yesterday. I didn't have much time to talk about the solutions, but I do have a detox protocol for protection against nuclear warfare, depleted uranium, and others. And I have many other protocols, and I custom do consults around the world, trying to help people whether they've got cancer, heart disease, or other problems, and they can contact me either on my websites or my phone number right there, 888-212-8871. And the reason why is they don't want you to know their alternative treatments for cancer. I have on my website experts, for example, Dr. Antonella Carpenter, that talks about treatments for cancer. It's available right now for breast cancer and skin cancer. There's no need for radiation or chemotherapy. They don't want you to know there's major things that can reverse a lot of the causes like diabetic neuropathy, which affects 1 in 20 diabetics. They don't want you to know that there's testing that should be done on all our vets, including our Canadian vets coming back that are exposed to excessive vaccine schedules or depleted uranium. And they want to suppress people like me that speak out. Believe me, I'm a medical legal doctor as well, which is like half an attorney also. So I'm witnessing right now in cases, like I have one radiation technologist in Purdue University that was exposed to so much radiation, so his bones are falling apart, so they're like a 120-year-old person, only he's only 42. I have a dentist in Florida who was exposed to mercury, and she lost two babies, and her other baby is getting autism at 20 months, and her brain is dying. So I'm working with her attorneys. And the reason why is because they try to silence people like me. They won't. Because I have the love of my family, my fellow man, all of the living things on this planet, and if you're not driven by that drive of emotion, that love, you will be nothing. Like as it says in the Bible, you'll be a sounding gong. You have to understand that this is really serious. We're at the, whether you come as an, you know, from the viewpoint of a native shaman, a Christian, an Islamic person, or a Jew, we are literally facing down balkanization at the end of history or the beginning of a new history, a new phase in humanity that's going to allow us to live in a peaceful, safe world with extended human lifespan. And why would this all happen now? Well, I'm going to try to give you some background to that before I do my talk. How many people know, after this, I'm sure if you're a novice to this, how many people think they know who is doing the New World Order? Right? That's a really weird term. If somebody told me this in medical school or residency when I went through my psychiatry portions of my residency, I'd say those people have got a fixed paranoid delusion. How many people think they know who's doing the New World Order? Put your hand up. OK, Okay, I want you to shout out a five-word answer of who's doing it.
Evil bastards.
That's too broad a term. Anyway, yeah, well, the international banksters are part of it, but the international banksters are just one part of the arm. I'm just going to give you a little background. Science and spirituality are never in conflict. The only difference is ignorance, okay? 10,000 or a million years from now, do you think the descendants of mankind will be ignorant, or do you think they'll be knowledgeable? If we're still here 1,000 or 10,000 or a million years from now, we'll know so much more that the idea of separate spiritual, separate religions, or the idea of a difference between science and religion will dissolve into non-existence. And that's a very important principle for people to understand. The portion of the globalists, and including the people who want to turn religion into a point of mind control, which is including, by the way, you don't realize that many of the things we don't call religion, like video games, movies, and, quote, our culture. And I remember driving around, I was out in California last month speaking at 3 conferences and 2 documentaries, and the kids wear the same uniforms there, or when I was in Denver just 2 days ago, or in Halifax, where I currently live. So there's lots of religions. They have a religion for the people that are in Iran, Afghanistan, okay? But we got to get beyond that. We got to get beyond our political parties. We got to get beyond our religions, beyond our skin color and our background, because they're dividing us, because they're getting ready, like on the chopping block, to separate, saute, flambe, and eat us, geopolitically, financially, and otherwise. They want to collapse the American dollar because you can't destroy wealth. You can just transfer it. So if they collapse the American dollar, they'll be able to buy everything up because the transnational corporatists, and if you look at Jeff Grubb's book, the transnational corporatists are ready to do it. They want to collapse. They want to fail in the 9/11 attack. If they actually thought there was a real enemy there, they would have probably put a million-man army, brought in all the advanced weapons, had proper alliances, and they would have won it in 2 weeks because of the power of their military. They wanted to fail. They failed miserably. Just as Homeland Security, as they fail, we're failing so miserably. Just give us more money and we'll get smarter and better. How many times do you think that they keep telling us that? Okay? Well, the background is the people that are our current overlords are descendants of ancient bloodlines. And people say, well, what? This sounds weird. It sounds like one of those Discovery Channel things. Well, the ancient bloodlines go back. If anybody, how many people here know what the Knights of Malta are? Okay, what do you think is on that cross? What does that cross signify in the front of their chest? It's not a Christian cross. It's a very ancient symbol. That symbol is older than ancient Sumeria. It goes back tens of thousands of years. It's a galactic cross. It's called the Star of the Crossing. And what that star stands for is that they know that periodically in the galaxy there are cataclysmic events that happen. And they're the keepers of the sacred knowledge that from one civilization crash to another, they keep the civilization or re-energize the power structure. It's a very tiny cabal. There's only about 2,000 or 3,000, literally, families that run the world. But they do it through dialectics of control that are very, very advanced. For example, if you go back and look in the Bible or look in other documents throughout the world, you'll find that the same people that created the wars, like Nimrod, actually had his armies go in and grab his own rabble that went and attacked the towns and cities. The Illuminati globalists that set up the Knights Templar in the Middle Ages paid off the robbers to rob to make sure that people would use their banking system of money notes so that you would give your money, your gold, to the Templar bankers, the banksters in the Middle Ages. And then when you walked on your pilgrimage to the Middle East to go to Jerusalem, you'd be safe because all the robbers would get is a piece of paper. That's what they're doing again. Only this time it's an electronic piece of paper with a chip in you, and everything is electronic divots in their system. So it's the same as the Knights Templar of the ancient times. It's the same people, okay? Now, without putting on labels, and there are various labels that I say on my show, which I may not say here in Canada because you don't have quite as much freedom of speech. But let's put it this way. If you go to my website, you'll see documents like the book Vatican Assassins. You'll see books like The Committee of 300 by Dr. John R. Coleman. You'll see books that explain who these people are, but they have many external masks. Those masks may look Catholic, they may look Jewish, they may look Protestant, they may look atheist or communist. They're all the same. Don't be dismayed by the fact that they have a different kind of mask. because this is all just a game for external consumption. Okay? So the New World Order is culminating now because they know there are things happening to our world. I'm primarily an environmental doctor. I started doing research in marine bacteriology back in the early 70s. Before I went into medicine, I did my honors biochemistry and research, PhD research in marine bacteriology. And I was one of the charter members of Greenpeace, so I am to the bone marrow an environmentalist. Okay, so when I went into medicine and afterwards, I did research on environmental toxicology of toluene diisocyanates and other chemicals. Global warming, and take this note now, this is something you need to know, is not my opinion. It's based on science. It's backed up by Professor Dr. Tim Ball, who lives here, of course, in British Columbia. Global warming is not, that's in capital 20-foot high letters, not caused by carbon dioxide. Now, you'll say, why is he saying this now? I'll tell you why. Because the key thing that they're going to use is the edge of the wedge, in the words of one of the founders of the Confederation, Joseph P. Howe, who's actually one of the founding fathers from Nova Scotia, where I currently live. It's called the edge of the wedge. The edge of the wedge is carbon dioxide, because if they claim that every person breathing out, we have to charge you $50 per head per year to breathe out. Now, if you breathe in only, you're okay. But at some point, you will pop. Now, you have to realize that they are talking about ruminating animals as the greatest scourge upon the face of the earth. So that means no more cows, no more sheep, no more meat. Now, if you want to know what happened in the Middle Ages, before in the 13th century, the British lords decided to control the population so that they couldn't go to the king's wood and they couldn't grow even certain vegetables without a note of writ from the lord of the shire or the manor. They reduced in height from an average height of 6'1" to 2" in the early Middle Ages, around the 12th century, to a height, an average height of between 5'1 and 5'3 because they were malnourished. Does anybody think that the World Trade Organization and the Codex Alimentarius is good for your health? No. And I'm going to list what they plan to do. They want to give you 7 of 9 banned pesticides. 2 of them are so lethal that in age under 5, 95% of children are dead in 48 hours. There are several others in there that will cause massive disease. They want to irradiate all the food that you have crossing any state border with 100,000 times the lethal dosage to kill viruses and bacteria. They want to put sulfuryl fluoride on your veggies so you don't have to worry about getting yourself toxic fluoride to calcify your nuclei of your brain and your drive centers. You can get it by eating your veggies. And you'd say, why would they do this when the science supports that this is toxic and causes cancer? That's the point. Why would they put aspartame in children's vaccines? Why would they put mercury ethyl salicylate that locks onto the beta subunit of neurotubulin so it cuts off your dendrites and causes autism or causes dementia in seniors? And if you have three, how many here people still get flu shots? Put up your hands. One more shot, and we have you pre-signed up for the Alzheimer ward. Because you need to realize their agenda is not in your best interest, and the medical community are an abomination. They don't have the guts to speak out to say the truth. And that means here in Canada, as well as the states, they need to hang their head low, because when the death camps start, believe me, doctor, we have a special place in the camp for you too. So if you're watching this later, go back and check the science. And if you don't agree with me, call me up personally, privately, at 888-212, or call on the radio show. And I will do a mental autopsy on you live on the show. Because, listen, doctor, when you plan on 27 vaccines in children at age birth, when you have 275 vaccines in Operation BioShield, which are, by the way, prepared for Canadians as well as Americans, and I have in my possession right now documents that I received today. This is from Fred Schwartz in Pennsylvania today. That's to the minute news. Fred Schwartz, right there. Important information about a test in your neighborhood. This is June 24th, 2007. That's today, Sunday. This is from the South Broad Street, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, to residential customers. And by the way, the Homeland Security Department does not allow you to opt out. So they are going to, and it's in the top, of course, it says, important information about a test in your neighborhood this Sunday. And the top paragraph is written in Spanish. La raza. For the race, everything. For everyone else, the shovel. If a bioterrorist attack happens in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia, large numbers of people may need medicine quickly to prevent sickness. Postal carriers may be able to get emergency medicine to people. Sounds like good to me, as Yoda says. On Sunday, June 24th, 2007, local, state, and national officials, they call them oaf-icials, are conducting an exercise to test the delivery of emergency medicine. Postal carriers are delivering mail, empty boxes that represent emergency medicine, containers to your neighborhood with loving care. I added the loving care. A Philadelphia police officer, armed by the way, will accompany the postal carrier worker as part of the test. Now, do you feel that you're living in 1984? Did you know that George W. Hairbush, the grandson of the primary funder through Brown Brothers Bank of the Nazis, click your heels together if you can, get ready to walk the Deutsch step. These guys are saying that you cannot turn them down. So they're trying to see what the public will do. How much will they respond now if we just poke them? You know, it's just a test. It says in the box there's vaccines. You know that after April Fool's Day, 2005, George W., and by the way, in every province, take notice of this now, there wasn't even public discussion or even news, but do you know that in the province of British Columbia and every province across the country in Canada, they need the premier and a quorum of three ministers, and they can order you to take a vaccine at gunpoint and be forced quarantined. That's today. Did you know that in your province of British Columbia? How many people knew that? Did you know that? I researched it. It's more overt in the States. Yeah, we're gonna kill you, and they tell you up front. Here in Canada, they're just going to do it. Okay? Don't think, with the squeaky clean image of Canada, and of course the mask has been taken off with Uranium City in Saskatchewan, Lavalin Corporation in Montreal and Calgary that make a lot of the munitions. You know that the major producer for the munitions, one of the major producers that produces the majority of small and large caliber arms, missiles, and weapons, for guns for the Israelis, is a Canadian company in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Did you know that? We need to start taking responsibility. And if there's one thing I tell people to get is, get connected to source. Whether it's you feel like I do, I'm connected to the Most High God, but get connected with your shaman leader or whatever. But start getting some spirituality back in you. Don't be a empty biological machine that's been drinking so much fluoridated water you have no drive or realize that you're about to be consumed in a holocaust and a maelstrom of evil. So that's reality. And if people want to have a look at it, I'll show the documents to them after. That is pretty hard to believe, but it's right there. So as I say, don't believe me now. One of the gentlemen outside just passed me this while I was walking around. Up to the minute news here, and again, every day I review the news on my radio show. I review all the news in the world, and believe me, there is no such thing as a sacred cow. I have a hammer for sacred cows to put them down, and I get them straight between the eyes. You'll see on my show more classified material and more going after the lies and deception on my show than pretty well anywhere else, because if we don't get rid of it, we're dead. We're not just talking about dead emotionally, spiritually, intellectually, financially, in every way, we're dead. And I have a family. I'm going to be gone soon. You know, maybe it's 100 years from now. Maybe it's 10 minutes from now. But I'll tell you, I'd rather live 10 days with liberty than 1,000 years in the belly of the beast. Canada's defense minister praises Rumsfeld leadership in letters. Anybody heard this? This is today's news. What an abomination, Rumsfeld. We call him Rummy. Mr. Aspartame, he'll fry your brain. While former U.S. Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld was packing his boxes at the Pentagon under a cloud of criticism for his handling of the war in Iraq, a friendly personal letter arrived from Ottawa applauding his leadership. Defense Minister Gordon O'Connor sent the letter to Mr. Rumsfeld 2 days before his planned departure from the last post December. President George W. Bush had announced a month earlier his long-awaited cabinet minister was being replaced to bring a fresh perspective. Well, I don't know. The stench from the minion of Satan himself, Mr. Rumsfeld, in that position. The Republicans had, and of course, they wanted to lose. They wanted to make sure the military campaign was a failure because their idea, they built 13 bases. They built the largest military base outside of the United States in central Iraq, right outside Baghdad. Did you know that? Yeah, 13 bases at billions and billions of dollars, like Carl Sagan. Billions of stars. Republicans had just lost a majority in Congress. So guess what? Mr. O'Connor, we need to give you a pack and slip, buddy. This kind of foolishness going on in our country when we are facing the annihilation not only of the national boundaries, we need united, independent nations, no nations, and a borderless, feudal, global, technocratic state by the globalist, satanic, Luciferian, bisexual idiots. Yeah. I slid that one in there underneath the CRTC guidelines. Canadian radio and television, bringing you the New World Order. Okay, I'm going to talk about a few other things now. I want to get into some topics here. I was the exit examining doctor for the forensics munitions team that came back from Oklahoma City from the Alfred P. Murrah building in 1995. And I don't know, I think I have a personality defect, which is probably the reason why I'm standing here today, and part of the reason why I'm still alive, because I got such a big damn mouth. Otherwise, if I knew what I knew, and I spoke even a little bit, I'd probably be killed a long time ago. But I guess because I'm an apple tree shaker, their biggest fear is not you people out there. It's the people inside the military, inside the corporations that are their people that might believe me. And they want to know who's going to bolt first. So they're monitoring and tracking information on them. Now, some of them might be you, too. You might be a publisher of articles. You might be a politician. You might be someone of interest. But they want to know who are, I call, the chain shapers, the people of the fulcrum, the people that make up the think tanks, the political parties, the corporate boards, the Borg, I call them corporate Borg, that actually are going to implement policies that are going to change it. The Patriot Act, I said this yesterday, but I want people to understand what Patriot Act is. It has nothing to do with patriotism. Providing advanced technologies to receive and intercept operational terrorism. And I have the Patriot Act, I've read it. I have also sections of other bills. And this is evil. I got the Homeland Security Patriot Act 2 years before 9/11 from my special op Delta friends in Norfolk, Virginia. In 1999, we ran special tests on Operation 97 and then later. We did Operation Dark Winter and Operation Top Off in Colorado. I was the point man under Reserve Admiral John Hughes, working with the Center for Disease Control and the FBI. And on March 1, a couple years after this, I met at the Adams Mark Hotel in Denver with a lunch with Dr. Jay Reddington, head of infectious disease at the University of Colorado VA Hospital, and the director for bioterrorism for the FBI and for the Center for Disease Control in a private lunch. For a couple hours. And I'm kind of one of the guys, you know. Hey, we're all in this together. So the FBI director leaned forward and said, there will be a Pearl Harbor event in a large northeast U.S. city that will bring a United States martial law with a 95% probability within 24 months and will result in chipping of the entire North American population and then the world. That's what he said, and he repeated it 3 times. Over the next hour and a half, after what's called plausibly deniable questions, he told me in great detail how their plan was to that there were operations that were going to be live war games, 17 plus live war games, including jets going into skyscrapers in lower Manhattan, nuclear bombs going off, possible bioweapons or chemical release, and that they would precipitate martial law. So when I was driving my kids to their Chatfield Charter School in South Denver in Highlands Ranch, Littleton, in 2001, September 11th, I knew they did it. Because when this forensics munition team back in 1995 told me, one of the five told me in great detail how he wanted me to look at this rash. He said, "Doc, Doc, look at my rash." I said, "Well, that just looks like a rash." He said, "No, you don't understand." I said, "No." I said, "If you, I'm a, like Becker on TV. Anybody know Becker? He's kind of that hard, crusty doctor a few years ago that was on TV that always had a bit of an edge to him. Well, I'm an old trauma burn emergency doc, so if you aren't telling me straight up, I'm going to not help you. If you do, I'll do anything for you because I care. But I don't like people lying to me." So he was, you know, and this guy's a special ops agent. He's a guy that would go in and put in bombs or take bombs out, works around explosive materials, and this guy was in a cold sweat with pinpoint pupils. I said, "What's making this guy so frightened?" "Doc, Doc, you don't understand." I said, "Tell me what happened." He says, "Oklahoma," he blurted out, "Oklahoma City, the Murrah Building was radioactive." I said, "Oh my God." I said, "I got a nut here." And then he said, "No, no," he said, "you don't understand. We removed two unexploded fourth generation U.S. Army Corps engineer micro nukes, a C4 pineapple, a large C4 bomb, C4 in the pillars, RDX, high explosive cord, and thermate." Thermate again. Again, thermate has been used before. "And they were tracking all their debris and were told that if they removed any radioactive debris, all the special agents," they were having all their bags scanned with Geiger counters and radiation detectors, "they would be tracked and killed." When they found out a few months later that he told me this, after 2 hours of him giving me great detail of how they had done the forensics on the Khobar Towers explosion, terrorist tower explosion in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia a few years earlier, and that that was 7 times larger ANFO, or ammonium nitrate, but it only blew the windows in, it was inferior concrete and steel and had virtually no effect. Virtually no effect on the building. He said, "The building was sheared by high explosives micro nukes." I said, "Oh my God." I went home at night. A few months later, when they found out, they court-martialed him, and they fired me on the spot and gave me death threats. That's confirmation. If you want to know if you're getting a nerve in surgery or in politics, see the response. If you get a denial by a government official or some corporatist functionary, you can be certain you've hit that nerve. Like whether they want to kill you or fire you. So right now, I'm going to present you some very serious data about what's going on here. Anybody seen this guy before? Now, he wants to be Der Führer of North America. His last name, of course, at Yale was Temporary. Did you know that was his name in the Yale Skull and Bones? How many people don't know that his name was Temporary? Temporary, yeah. They have to have, I call, a sock puppet. He is like the Elmo to the New World Order. Have to have a little humor here. This is so dark, you have to have some humor. 1988, Tom Scott Gordon, who's a photographer at the World Trade Center complex, he was hired by the Port Authority of New York to take pictures for demolition. These buildings were planning demolition for almost 20 years before 9/11. Ruby Ridge, Randy Weaver's family were attacked with wife and kid. Wife, was, her head was blown off and her child killed by ATF agents. Larry Pratt was the same FBI officer that ran the operations at Ruby Ridge and Waco and was the operational officer of the FBI at Elohim City in Oklahoma City that killed the brother of Jesse Trentadue, an attorney in Salt Lake City. I gave my affidavit 3 months ago about the proof that ATF and FBI special agents were running the entire operation. Got it? It was done by the U.S. government. They killed 168 citizens. I have V.Z. Lawton and others that I've had on my radio show. This was a crime against humanity, and the crime in 9/11 killed citizens of 82 nations, including Canadians. But yet, our Canadian government has the nerve to not investigate when there's full integration of NORAD. There's another NORAD headquarters in North Bay, Ontario, another full integration of the U.S. Space Command, Strategic Defense, and Star Wars, the Dew Line, etc., all of these early warning systems, and yet no one in Canada has raised the issue that in order for 9/11 to occur, there had to be full complicity with the Canadian military and the Canadian intelligence establishment of CSIS and the Royal Canadian Mounted Fuzz. Do you follow? We can't be quiet Canadians anymore. This is enough is enough. Why has there not been an investigation? There have been calls for a repeated 9/11 investigation in the U.S., but guess what? We have a Canadian can opener, and we need to open up this can of ugly worms. Why has there been complicity? The uranium came from Uranium City, Saskatchewan, but guess what? The general that shot down the supposed Flight 93 over Shanksville, Pennsylvania, was a Canadian general. No one's talking about the fact that they were playing red team, blue team. I know about it because I worked in Operation Top Off in Dark Winter, and I have friends in NORAD, U.S. Base Command Strategic Defense. And although I'm a civilian, I work with the military for almost 30 years, I can tell you these Canadians are just as guilty and just as complicit as the American bastards that did 9/11. Okay? So let's not think that we're, you know, be arrogant Canadians over this. We have to start facing the ugly truth of what's gone on, that we haven't called for an investigation in Canada. Lenin said, show me the man and I will show you the crime. The Patriot Act, turning citizens into suspects since 2001. And by the way, there's no fly list. When I came here, I said to my wife, because I saw it announced the 18th, I said, well, I'll find out if I'm on a no-fly list. Because when I flew around, I did a lot of flying in the last 3 or 4 years back and forth to the States as I closed my practice and literally started doing this full-time 3 years ago. My bags disappeared so often, it was ridiculous. I thought they went to China and back. I get tags through my thing, TSA stuff, material stuffed all over the place. They must have thought I was shipping micro-nukes. Wackenhat Security, by the way, is guarding the treasure of the debris, the sacred sacrifice of Oklahoma City in a concrete capped-off facility. And the Wackenhat Security is owned by Carlyle Group, which the Bin Ladens, the royals, the queen, our wonderful queen, and George Bush and the Bin Laden families own. Isn't that wonderful? This is a picture of the front sheared off by not just regular explosives, but micronuclear bombs and C4 and high explosive cord of the highest quality you can only get in the U.S. military. This shows you the World Trade Center complex map, a three-dimensional map. And what you can see here is you can see the positions of World Trade Center 6, 1, 2, and 7. And by the way, we know 7. No steel structure was ever followed by anything, even fires that were prolonged. This is spoken of many times, but I'm going to show you 30 anomalies today, 30 anomalies that can only be explained by the presence of the kind of explosive material and actions that occur with a nuclear device. Now, I fully believe that Professor Jones has proved beyond a reasonable doubt, and I'm a medical legal doctor, that there was thermite in the building. And my thesis is this, okay, if you take this from this meeting, they cut the lower floors because according to Professor Crockett Grabe, a University of Iowa physicist and University of Caltech, that the floors had to fall away from each other from the bottom because if they pancaked, they would slow their descent by inertial momentum to 96 seconds. That's his calculations. So the floors had to be cut and blown out so the squibs would blow out, and the floors had to collapse away from each other and fall toward the base. But if you take the evidence of all of the witnesses, including William Rodriguez, you had to have bombs in the area around the core and then down in the basement and the sub-basement, which would have stripped off the flesh off that gentleman that came up the elevator shaft that William Rodriguez references to. And you had to have the disappearance of the radio tower that literally, you can see on video, turned to a vapor. A 90-foot tower becomes a vapor in a fraction of a second. And do you know anything else, including high explosives, that'll do that? No. The only thing that'll do it is a micro-nuke. Now, I was to go into nuclear physics at MIT because I had special aptitudes in advanced chemistry and nuclear physics. And I can tell you, having worked as an occupational doctor and a member of the nuclear division of ACOM, yes, there was thermite. We have proof from their own U.S. Geological Survey there was also tritium, 1.1 billion, with a B, tritium units, at a minimum at World Trade Center 6. There was also 55 times background, and we have data pending from Industrial Analytical Services in Leominster, Massachusetts, and 3 specimens coming. I don't have it yet. I'm a scientist. I can't claim that I have it. But when you look at these anomalies, I'm just asking what I call Charlie Sheen questions. I don't have the answers yet, but when you look at this, is to say, if it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it's not a moose. Okay? This shows you the core, 47 giant girders going to a quarter mile. Imagine the hundreds of thousands, millions of tons of steel, 5,000 tons of asbestos per tower, 100,000 tons of glass, millions of tons of steel girders, 4 feet thick, 47 of them, going a quarter mile into the sky. Can you imagine that turning into a vapor, an atomic vapor, in fractions of a second? Can you imagine it falling at free fall speeds which defy Newtonian physics? And believe me, the laws of physics were not suspended on 9/11 for that portion of space and time. Well, Dr. Ed Ward kind of made me aware of this, so I went back and researched, and I'm a real information hound, so I like to analyze it. So I saw this on Jeff Rentz's website, and it was referencing to an anonymous Finnish munitions expert who's still in active service. He is a shape charge expert, a nuclear demolitions expert in Finland. He came up with a number of anomalies that he found that indicated to him that there were the probability, again, I'm saying this probability because I'm a scientist, I can't say it's absolute yet, but by next week, if we have one test positive in 100 for these heavy isotopes, we have proof. But I already have the tritium data from their numbers, from the U.S. Geological. And then we take a number of things, the FLIR satellite infrared laser imaging, massive craters, footprint of the fallen World Trade Center. Then we have Ted Tweetmeyer. He's a Department of Defense engineer, NASA engineer, and he has analyzed the data and shown very significant proof of non-thermal paramagnetic effects, and I'll explain what that means. How many people here use electricity? Those who don't are asleep. When you have a little magnetic paramagnetic disc, it's an aluminum disc inside your little meter in your home, and you get eddy currents of electricity when you put electricity through that. So as you draw more power, the disc spins faster and has little gears that will add up how many kilowatts or whatever of power you're using. When you have an EMP, which is what we call giga Tesla, Tesla is a magnetic field equivalent, hundreds of thousands of Tesla magnetic field. So if you look at a magnetic field machine like an MRI, it's say 1.2 or 1.8 Tesla, T-E-S-L-A, the father of, you know, alternating current, the father of hydropower, the father of transmission of power by alternating current, as well as the Tesla coherence interferometry in terms of the Star Wars weapon systems that they've deployed. When you have a very powerful Tesla field, that pulse can cause paramagnetic effects. So you can have engine blocks blow up, and you can blow up aluminized mirrors. Has anybody seen a similarity here? The Strack sedan hydrogen bomb test in the World Trade Center, does that look similar to you? How many people don't not see a similarity? Just like one of these things doesn't. Well, they look similar because they're called a pyroclastic flow. This is like a volcano. It occurs when you have very, very superheated gases. They become literally a heavier than air particle and heated, superheated mass that can be tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of degrees. And as they flow out, they can move at enormous speeds, hundreds of miles per hour. This is an FLIR infrared satellite photo on September 18th. Hotspots on October. Still hot. That doesn't make sense. How come it's still hot? It's actually still hot on February 12th, 2002. There were lakes. We're talking about lakes, not for fish, by the way. These are lakes of liquid molten metal. And yes, you will get liquid molten metal from thermate, but you can't get the lakes of molten metal and hundreds, you know, millions of tons of steel turned to atomic particles from thermate alone. You cannot. That's just a physical. And you can calculate it back. There's a thing called the amount of joules, heat joules of energy required to convert steel into an atomic or a nanoparticle vapor. An atomic vapor, okay? Because two-thirds of the mass of the buildings disappeared. And guess what? They didn't even do it in Las Vegas. Okay? And you'll look at this, you say, I can't believe that. Does anybody see this radio tower go poof? 90-some foot radio tower just goes, see it right up there. It's gone. And the reason why it's gone is it was vaporized. It wasn't a Star Wars weapon. If anybody says that foolish theory, let me tell you, that's easy to debunk. What I'm going to show you isn't easy to debunk. And even if only 10% of the debris of the building was affected by what we're going to talk about here, only one specimen in 100 is positive. And I'll show you why. If you look at this Giga Tesla EMP electromagnetic pulse effect, the lines of force vectors, and this is what Ted Tweetmeyer did, he drew out the lines of vectored force hitting all paramagnetic objects, including plenum chambers and air conditioners. Power outage, by the way, and this is all consistent with the data, with a very large radius. It took him 3 to 4 months to get the power back up to that area. The power was out, and all these air conditioners were fried because they're made of aluminum, which is paramagnetic. People are paramagnetic, so guess what happens when an EMP pulse hits people? They turn to dust. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Does that sound like a funeral? People are instantly turned to bone ash. So when you see people walking around after 9/11, it wasn't just wall board that they had on them. It was people dust. Does that make your stomach turn? Does it make you angry? If you don't feel a gut-wrenching rage, as it says in the Bible, be angry and sin not. If you aren't angry at the end of this conference, a rage that will continue for days, weeks, months, and as humanity, forever. This is a day of infamy that needs to be remembered by humanity for thousands of millions of years to come. This should never happen again. Look at the Fire Department of New York and Port Authority police vehicle mirrors and so on, all caught it catching fire and exploding. Yet other things, if it was just a thermal pulse from a regular conventional weapon, are not affected. Paper is not paramagnetic, so guess what? It's all over the place. Look at these lines of force. These are drawn by Ted Tweetmeyer from the direction of the World Trade Center, so you see the front of the building fried and the back virtually fine. Look at this, Fire Department of New York. Engine block exploded. Yet the tire's still okay in the back. It gives you a bit of a structure of what a nuclear bomb looks like. Okay, this is what I call nuclear bomb 101. Do not watch this if you're Al-Qaeda. I call it LCIADA. You have trinitro toluene. This is an old-style bomb, by the way. It's not your regular Walmart bomb. Split material in the form of a globe of plutonium-239 around it, or uranium-235, and then a neutron source. And often, by the way, around this, they have what's called a depleted uranium casing, going right back to the original bombs of Fat Man and so on that they dropped on Nagasaki and Hiroshima. Because when you hit these cobalt casing, when you hit cobalt, it goes from cobalt-59 to cobalt-60, which turns the bomb into a radioactive dust bomb that makes the place that you hit radioactive to kill everything for months and years. And so they're called dirty bombs. This shows you a micro-nuke bomb. It gives you a little bit of idea of what they look like. You have a beryllium source called beryllium-9, and you have polonium-210. Does anybody know about the name Litvinenko? Does that ring any bells? Mr. Litvinenko, by the way, the amount of polonium he must have been exposed to is equivalent of about, they figure, between $2 and $4 million worth of polonium-210, because that's how hard it is to come by it. He was apparently working for one of the oligarchs, okay, which are one of these mafia types. And he was transporting this stuff. And, of course, it's been thought he was working actually for MI6 because they're trying to bring in an orange revolution in Russia. Lots of bad things. And you'll see lithium deuteride, which is a source of deuterium, which is why when you combine these lithium deuteride molecules with your neutron source, which is the beryllium-9, you end up with the production of a lot of tritium. Tritium, which is heavy water. So you have, and again, without getting into too much detail, we have the fissionable material in there, and you have, if you call a primary fission bomb and a fusion bomb. So these are more advanced. The latest fourth generation ones involve what's called these very, very high powered, what's called Giga Tesla type generators, capacitors, that can generate these massive magnetic pulses for picoseconds or millions of seconds. Other ones involve these very, very high energy pulse lasers that can cause neutron ejection and cause the triggering of a nuclear explosion without using all these other types of triggers. So these are available, they're called fourth generation. What I'm telling you is classified information, but I'm releasing it because you need to know. You have to understand this, by the way, if you hear disclaimers by people that are professors in physics at universities, 4% of information is available up to the PhD level in universities, Canada, the United States, and Europe. 96% is on a need-to-know basis if you're invited. Take that home when you go home to realize if somebody says that can't happen, like you can't use scalar things to neutralize depleted uranium, no weapon is deployed that an antidote has not been developed by the other side. So they wouldn't put DU out there. I don't know what it is, but I've been told that Nikola Tesla, because I researched this, does have Tesla scalar technology to take radioisotopes and neutralize them. They have other technologies. You can be guaranteed that the fools that did this will leave it out to salt the land like Carthage, but they will then also have the antidote for themselves, just like the avian flu. So we're looking at things like isotopes of beryllium-9, polonium-210, uranium, yttrium. By the way, yttrium showed up in the U.S. Geological Report, which is a very unusual metal that shows up in, as a component in neutron reflectors in nuclear bombs. Okay, so we're looking at a number of isotopes for analysis. By the way, I'll go back here, but the iron, you can get heavy isotopes of iron-58 from insertion of neutrons. These fast neutrons get ejections at millions of electron volts of power, and they enter the nuclei. So if you look at these isotopes, and I'm going to show you here, these are just some of the ones that are, if you look at the data for naturally occurring, you know, things like silicon and so on, carbon, it shows you the percentage which are natural, and it shows you the silicon 29, what percentages, et cetera. Now, when you have a what's called a neutron flux with a nuclear explosion, and it mixes, it hits the neutron, the nucleus, some of these will pick up those neutrons and they become radioactive and others become stable non-radioactive elements. Okay? This is a theory, and it's well supported. We're testing in our first pass three of those isotopes. You'll see them in color, niobium-93 and 94. Niobium-94 has a half-life of 20,000 years, and it should not be present above 8.3 parts per million. We're looking also at beryllium-9. Okay? Beryllium-10, if we look at beryllium-10, we should not have more than 3 parts per million. So if we find, I don't know, 3,000 parts per million of beryllium-10, we got them. They use nukes. And beryllium, being a neutron source in a nuclear weapon, if it's present, will indicate without any shadow of a doubt, this is degrees of medical evidence for indictments of treason and mass death. We are dealing with mass killers of nations. Cobalt-59, if we find cobalt-60, it has a half-life of 5 years, but it still should be present. So we'll see if it shows. Again, we'll have the first of our three samples next week. This is showing when you have the two tritium ions, you get tremendous energy release, right, when you have these two in a nuclear reaction. I'm just going to show you quickly, without looking at each of the lines of this, the calculations we've gone through many times from the U.S. Geological, from the actual estimations of water used by the Port Authority in New York and the fire department, as well as the rain, and the actual calculations of tritium in the water there, and they were trying to say at first it was due to tritium in exit signs, which is ridiculous. Oh, yeah, the exit signs did it. I don't think so. I think GW and his brother, Marvin, and this is my information from my NSA classified sources, under Project Omega, which is an overseeing agency of all secret agencies on the planet, the Israeli Mossad put the nuclear devices and these other devices in there, along with other agencies of the United States government, to demolish the building on purpose. And everything, including the jet aircraft, was false. In fact, they don't even have proof that it was regular aircraft. What I was told from my Air Force comrades is that, in fact, they were E-10s that were remotely flown in there. By the way, every commercial airliner for the past 30 years can be taken over by remote control. There isn't one that can't be. So he did the calculations, and you can show very significantly that the samples we calculated are 55 times higher than background. 55, so have a look at that, 55 times higher than background levels. So we determine the exact amount of water. You can go on my website, clayandiron.com. You can pull up the PowerPoint, look at it. If you're a skeptic, go to the links. They're right here. That's right for the government links for their data. In other words, there were government agents that obviously knew this was an inside job, planted the data like an egg hunt. You ever gone on an egg hunt? Guess what? There's where the eggs are. Okay? So you need to look at that. And I'm just going to skip forward because I want to show you these anomalies. All right. If you look at World Trade Center 6 in Acre, And you can see the actual calculations. We figured out how much water, et cetera, et cetera. Look through the numbers yourself, and you'll see. Now, there's 30 anomalies, and I'm going to try to go through these fairly auspiciously, but you can go step by step. And again, the first start of these numbers was started by our anonymous munitions expert then, Mr. Shaw and Rick Siegel of the Blue Star Media Group. They're actually putting together a documentary DVD movie. Number one, superheated steel beams creating a steel vapor comet trails when falling. Submicron pulverization, 99% of the concrete and floors. 330-ton sections of the outer wall ripped off. Ponds of molten metal in the basements. And we're not talking about little deposits of metal, but metal, even from thermite, would be gone in days or weeks, but not 100 days. It wouldn't be there 100 days. And the temperatures were estimated at 2,500-plus degrees, literally 500 to 800 degrees hotter than the hottest temperatures of a jet aircraft engine operating at perfect ignition and carburation of the jet fuel and oxygen at the back of the turbine. So it's absolutely not possible. This is a meteor, they call it, one of the many meteors that's kept at the Kennedy Airport hangar. It weighs about 4.5 tons. It's molten metal all agglomerated together with steel rods. Okay? This shows that the LIDAR infrared satellites that showed, in fact, some of the places were actually below ground level. The debris piles were so tiny because most of the building literally was turned into a vapor and blown away. How many times have you seen a building blown away just by even conventional explosives, whether it's the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas or any other hotel? It can't occur. 100 days required to cool down. Pyroclastic, massive plumes of debris. We showed you in the pictures. People, computer, and furniture vanished. Vanished. They found body parts 4.5 years later on the roofs, a half a mile away of people. Does anybody feel like vomiting now? I'm a trauma doctor, but that makes me sick. Pieces of thighs, bones, skulls. 20% of the World Trade Center dust is made of metals of atomic sizes. And by the way, I can tell you right now that even the most powerful conventional explosives, thermite, super thermite, any other explosives will not turn the mass of 2/3 of these massive millions of tons buildings into atomic vapors. They can't. This shows you the debris outside. Literally, I call it people dust and paper. 9, World Trade Center 1 transmission tower falls, first indicating central support was removed. Tritium levels 55 times background. Witnesses say cars exploded. And by the way, some of them exploded as far away as a half a mile on FDR Drive away, line of sight for the World Trade Center because of the paramagnetic surge that blew up the engine blocks and exploded the mirrors. Wide power outages cut off communications in a very large area. Look at this guy, he's standing on people dust. These are burned out vehicles that are stored still. And vehicles, we're talking about literally fried, the internal electronics fried, the engine blocks fried, the mirrors all blown out. Winter Garden hit by 20-ton steel ejected 600 feet from the World Trade Center. Sharp spikes in seismograph at the Lamont Doherty Earthquake Lab. And by the way, this was showed it was like a nuclear explosion. I can tell you, nothing but nukes, micro nukes, will do this, okay? Brown shades of color in the air due to the radiation forming nitric oxide from nitrogen in the air. It causes the nitrogen to be so activated, it forms nitric oxide, and it forms brown clouds of nitric oxide in the air. Huge expansive clouds taking 5 times the volume of the tower. And by the way, conventional explosives, if you've ever seen any other building demolished to put up a new hotel in Las Vegas or elsewhere, you won't see these huge expansive clouds. And that's the Lamont Doherty that shows literally a 2.1 equivalent earthquake. Rubble height, only 10%. And this is very damning, by the way, because when 23% of the building is just not even there. And by the way, the height of the towers was only 10% of original instead of 33%. So any building ever demolished in the world is 33%. It's a standard rule of demolition. No survivors found except for one isolated stairway without overhead debris. Decontamination procedures seen at World Trade Center, so they're using high-pressure decontamination down there. And by the way, I'm writing the position paper for the American Academy of Environmental Medicine worldwide for Lower Manhattan. I'm the author. And I'm reviewing all the 400-plus types of cancers, which are only seen, and I worked around radioisotopes for decades. I can tell you, are only seen around people exposed to radiation, radioisotopes, and radioactive debris of nuclear weapons like at Rocky Flats. Rooftop, 200,000-gallon water tanks for sprinkler systems, no water in the ruins. Forensic toxicology of trace minerals and isotopes found, and we're looking at these right now. Stay tuned, listen to my show, and if I don't find it in the sample, I'm not going to give up. I'm a bloodhound, and I can smell blood. Cancers are rare types, secondary. Again, if Alex Jones is a bulldog, I'm a Rottweiler. Cancers are rare types, secondary to radiation nanoparticles. We don't want lunch to get cold. We don't want radioactive debris to get cold either. We'll be finished in a minute here. I'm sure your stomachs will be still hot from what I'm going to tell you. Cancers are rare types secondary to radiation and nanoparticles. Very rare cancers, like non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. By the way, my daughter was conceived within a year and a half after the first Gulf War, and guess what she has? She has Down syndrome. I guarantee you that there are children around the world, not just in Afghanistan, but in our hemisphere, and people that have got diseases or are dying now or will die from 9/11. Did you know that the world concentration of dioxins and dibenzofurans, which are folate metabolite inhibitors, the same as chemotherapy? Okay? The world is now on chemo. Did you know that? Did you know that the concentrations of these molecules doubled in the whole world? In the whole world. Fibrotic lung conditions secondary to heavy metals and radioisotopes. And by the way, they didn't just die of these toxic levels of these particles. They died of other things. 400 cancers, thyroid, tongue, throat, testicular, brain, breast, prostate. Really unusual cancers that only occur with radioisotopes. Got it? I'm a doctor. I work with these people. I've seen them come from Rocky Flats and other places. These cancers only occur with the people working down there that were doing the rescue workers with exposure to radioisotopes. Bone dust cloud around the World Trade Center, found in the spring of 2006, they found from the Deutsche Bank building roof. That's a long time after 9/11. Massive craters, they actually had craters. Some of these were actually below ground level. Radiation at Great Kill, Staten Island, shut down acres of the site. They actually shut it down because they were scanning the fall of 2005. They brought a law in New York. They had to scan the city for radiation to make sure there was no radiation or anything like that. I don't know why they did that. But the military has been doing that for 20 years over all U.S. and Canadian cities every week to scan the cities for radiation. Did you know that? Do you know that Canadian cities like Vancouver, Toronto are scanned every week? Not only from space-based satellites, but aircraft that fly over to actually look down on the ground for radioisotopes. Infrared satellite-based photos showing molten steel and magma. They turn the buildings into molten metal magma. 14 rescue dogs and some rescue workers died very soon afterwards, which never occurs even with nanoparticles. In other words, even if you're just talking about high explosives, they don't die like that. Okay? And they were also the typical kind of death caused by alpha particle emissions, okay? Alpha particles and tritium. And one alleged radiation spot, and this is one of the ringers, found afterwards in Manhattan's east side had a potential for becoming a political hotspot, a radiation spot found only at the Israeli embassy. Interesting, eh? And officials would not comment. Yeah, I'm just wrapping it up here. So what we have is, I agree with Dr. Jones. I know that he has proof that the thermite was in the building. There's no doubt that the thermite cut the floors. But if you combine everything together, what you have is they had to have the floors falling away and they had to vaporize the core, whatever they used. I think it must have been micronukes. Maybe they have some new type of weapon or explosive that I'm not aware of. But with all of the anomalies here, the only thing that can make to a common sense person with a scientific background and a forensic background like I have is that this must have been a combination of layers of explosives, including thermite, micronukes to literally blow the building up from the basement, ground level, and from the roof, and blow the floors from the bottom up and blow the squibs out. And this shows you, of course, some of the pictures that you're familiar with. So we have the tests coming back from Industrial Analytical Services. Those tests, the first batch of tests will be next week. Some of the material is the same material that was sent from Janet McKinley. Is the first batch. The second one is coming from Mike Rivero and whatreallyhappened.com. And the third batch is coming from a lady who actually was in the towers, who is a daughter of a CIA agent, who is sending that directly to me. So you can learn more by listening to my radio show. The website, NutriMedical, NutriMedical.com, clay and iron. I'll be back this afternoon talking about some solutions. later on talking about solutions for detox and living in a toxic world. But I want you to think. I don't have the final answers yet, but I'm real close, and like a bloodhound, I can smell blood. Thank you.